part of the Boy Scout oath goes like this. On my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country. Our guest today, Father Frank Zero from Our Lady of Perpetual Help in Lindenhurst, understands this sentiment. After all, he is an Eagle Scout. Today, Father Zero will share with us his vocation story here on It's a Wonderful Life. Welcome back to It's a Wonderful Life. We're joined today by Father Frank Zero, the associate pastor at Our Lady of Perpetual Help in Lindenhurst, and not only just a priest brother, but a dear friend that I've known for many, many years. Father Frank, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Frank, one of the great things about your walk and your journey is really not only just your journey to the priesthood, but really how the whole family was converted by your love for the Lord. Can you speak to us about how those seeds were planted early?
Well, it happened when I was in first grade, Father Joe. It happened when I was in my religious education class. As you know, I went to public school throughout, and I was a special education student, which meant I would be bumped from school to school throughout, and I didn't have many friends or anything. And I went to the religion class that first day, and back in that time, they would ask, how many of you went to Mass on Sunday? And at that point, there were a lot of people who could raise their hand. I was not one of them. So I went home, and I would ask my parents about going, oh, don't worry about it, you don't need to do that. And then ultimately, after bugging them and pestering them for 6 months, almost a year, they finally said, okay, we'll go to Mass, and you're going to get over it real quick. You're going to find it's really boring. Well, obviously, I didn't get over it so quickly because I'm sitting here with you today. And it developed from there. They would become supportive over time. When I first told them I wanted to be a priest, it was probably around third grade, maybe fourth, and they said, you're a little young to be thinking about that yet. Why don't you take a little longer? But ultimately, they would come around to it as I kept talking about it. My parish priest was very encouraging, Father Tom Fusco, when he got there when I was in high school, very, very encouraging of vocations and the priesthood. And I found in church a place where we had an even playing field. As I said, in school, we really didn't have that. I was went from school to school. Maybe there'd be two grades in one school because it was self-contained, and then another two in another school. So making friends was difficult, at least in the elementary school years. And I would go off to junior high school, and I was a really shy person back then, not that you believe that now, really shy person, and didn't really come out at all to friends or family, yes, but didn't really have many friends. And I would enter the scouting program, where I would find some lifelong friends now that I still have to this day. And the older scouts really broke me out of that shell, showed me that you could trust people again. Mm. And that really did help. Over time, I would become a sacristan, a youth lector at one point, and then I work in the office. So I would see the priests living the life of the priesthood and giving that great example of what it meant to really serve God and his people, which really meant a lot.
Well, Father Frank, too, even like I lived at St. Edward's for a long time when you were either in the seminary or at mm-hmm. that point you were a priest. And right. And so just seeing in your family, like your family was involved right. in either scouting or the mm-hmm. fire department or in working in the right. church, and just to see how powerful one mm-hmm. one desire like you had to say, let's right. go to Mass, it can really transform the whole family.
Yeah. What ended up happening was they began to get really involved in the church. They became religious education teachers. My father and mother both became New Eucharistic ministers at the parish, and then they ran the festival, as you know, for many, many years. So they were involved in a deep way in the parish. I believe they also did pre-cana at one point. So yeah, one person can make a huge difference, and it doesn't matter if you're a special education student, someone who's learning disabled, someone who doesn't think they can do much. I want to tell the young people today, it doesn't matter where you are in life and what you think you can accomplish because of education-wise, you can accomplish a great deal with God's help, and he's always there for each one of us.
That's awesome. Well, I remember you coming in the first day at the seminary. You were mm-hmm. a rookie. I was a senior, and then before you knew it, you were assigned to your first parish, Holy Family yep. in Hicksville. Mm-hmm. That was a pretty turbulent summer. Why don't you talk a little bit about that first assignment and that first summer?
It was. It was a great assignment. I really did enjoy it. I was pleased to be assigned there. The pastor I knew for many years, Father Gerard Gentleman, through the scouting program himself. He was the former chaplain. I'm now involved in chaplaincy with scouts. And at that point in time, it was a turbulent summer. I got to the parish on the end of June, because ordinations were late that year. The pastor wasn't even there. I had met with him, I guess it was a week or two prior to getting to the parish, and he gave me my keys, showed me where everything was, and said, I'm going to be away, but I trust you. And then I guess it was about 2 weeks into it, I get a call from him. He's out in Philmont Scout Ranch and says, there was a young person, 10 years old, lost their life at Yagug Scout Camp. I need you to go and be present to that family and minister to them at their time of need and be there at the funeral and at the wake. So it was difficult, but I rose to that challenge with God's help, of course, because without him, I wouldn't have been able to do it.
So let's just back this up.
Mm-hmm.
You're a priest a couple of weeks.
Right. 2 weeks, 3 weeks,
and
tops.
It's not like, hey, where's the sacristy and, you know, who's bringing up the water and the wine at Mass?
Right.
Your first big experience was dealing with a 10-year-old who passed away and ministering to that family. How'd you have the words?
The words came to me from God, I think. I really do. Because there aren't real words you can give to people at that time besides God loves you, we're here to support you. And those words came. I can't even remember what they were, to be honest. And that's why I think they really did come from God. It came from a deep sense of prayer. My family was very supportive at that point. They knew what was going on. And so were my closest friends, some of which were in that parish. Not in the parish where the child had passed, but in the parish I was assigned to. So I had that support network. And older priests that I went to as well, who were very helpful.
Well, Father Frank, the other thing, too, is speaking on those lines with friends and connections, like, there has been an incredible resurgence from the parish, Holy Family, mm-hmm. and particularly with vocations and through the young people, the youth group. And what would you say, what's going on there? Like, what's happening? What was your presence or your experience or your witness that helped with that?
I have a feeling Father Gerard was very influential in having a priest down at every youth group meeting. And I was assigned to do that as a young guy in the house. And I'd go down to each and every youth group meeting. It was establishing first that relationship with the young people, that they trusted you, they know you, they can come to you. And just being present, it wasn't necessarily running an activity every meeting. Sometimes it was just standing around and chit-chatting with the young people. And I think the experience of them seeing a priest who was happy with what he was doing, who was fulfilling God's will, and happy while doing it.
Sure.
And just being there present to them and showing them that we're regular people. The idea is that they'd hear me, oh, well, what did you do this weekend, Father? Well, I went out with a friend, or I went over to my family's house. And they saw a priest as a real person,
right,
rather than just that person that's off in the distance up on an altar. Because there's a real disconnect between the youth and priests. And I think when we bridge that gap, it's a great help to promote vocations.
Well, Father Frank, you move from Holy Family over to Our Lady Perpetual Help in Lindenhurst, and again, face some challenges there. There's been a few tragedies that you've had to journey through.
Yep.
But what about some of the high points? What are some of your day-to-day joys about being in the parish there?
I love religious ed. I'm involved in that in a huge way, and that has been a huge influence on me. Also, has been a huge influence on me is really trying to get a youth group kick-started again.
Okay.
Which is not easy to do, but it's something I think is very, very necessary, and we're trying to get that started. So those are two areas.
Well, back in the day, I was the youth minister there at OLPH.
Were you? That I did not know.
Yes, from 2000, 2001, so, yep. But just before I went to the seminary, so I'm hoping that you can resurge that as well.
Well, we're trying.
What would you say is, and you're talking about youth, but what's your favorite part of ministry in general when you're in the parish?
My favorite part of ministry in general would be, I guess, the Eucharist, bringing God to people. I feel that's the most important thing that we do, because the Eucharist is that source and summit of our faith.
Are you, Lindenhurst is a big community and a big parish. What are some outreach aspects that you all have? I know that after Sandy, there was a lot going on, and that really created a great relationship between the community and the church. What are some other outreach opportunities that are going on in Lindenhurst?
We have community meals for people who are less fortunate, once to twice a month, and once a week, if not more often, we have a food van or a homeless ministry van that goes around and supports those who are living on the streets in their time of need.
Do you think, and again, living in that area, is it what's going on? Like, why is it that even, like, we're talking about Long Island, we're not talking about, you know, other types of parts of the world that might be, say, oh, that's a third world country.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think it is so much that, is there a need for this kind of ministry in a place like Lindenhurst?
I think there's a need everywhere. I really do. Because just because it doesn't look like an underprivileged area, it doesn't mean that there aren't people living out in the streets among us. You go to Syosset, you find the same thing. You go anywhere at Hicksville, you find them in that area too. They're all over, and they need the support regardless of whether it's an affluent area or a non-affluent area. I think sometimes we walk by people and don't even notice that they're living on the street. And the gospel tells us that we're to go and try to minister and be with those people, be that good person who doesn't just walk by them and walk by on the opposite side of the street because we're scared of them or because they look different than us.
The passion that you have for this, like, where do you think that came from? Like, you talked about some of the challenges when you were a young person, mm-hmm. and you were a little bit shy, and you're not shy anymore.
Try.
So maybe there's someone out there that might be that young Father Frank who is a little mm-hmm. bit shy. What are some recommendations that you would say to maybe come out of that comfort zone to be a little bit more evangelical and right. coming out and reaching out?
I found, for me at least, the scouting program was huge in my life, and as you said before, still huge in my life. I'm the chaplain of that now. I'm an Eagle Scout. I think that really helped me in a big way, and to find people who are older than me, not much older, but maybe a year or two older, who were those who would help me get out of that shell. It's hard to describe.
Sure.
But that's the way I would go about it, I'd say, through youth programs at parishes, because there are great people in this world, great young people. And I think sometimes a shy person would have a difficulty because of bullying that goes on in schools or other things, where in youth groups and in scouting, you have that area where kids try to be good to one another. Doesn't always work, but sometimes does.
You talked about being an Eagle Scout. Quickly, could you tell us mm-hmm. what your Eagle project was?
Yes, I did a bicycle registration for the Nassau County Police Department. At the time, they had a program if bicycles were stolen. There was a sticker affixed on each bike that was registered that cannot be taken off that would help the police be able to locate that bike a lot easier.
Wow. Where'd you come up with that idea?
By calling around. Police departments asking them, what's something I could do that's different? And or speaking to the people in government, what can I do that's different? I mean, there were blood drives and things of that nature, which are great, but I wanted something different, something that was going to make a difference and be long lasting.
We have about 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. You said at first your parents were not as maybe forthgoing into getting involved in the community. What mm-hmm. words of encouragement would you give to parents today to get their young folks involved?
To really be supportive, to encourage. When a young person would come and say, I want to be a priest or a religious sister or a religious brother, to be supportive, it's a great life. I know some parents think that it could be difficult, it can be lonely. I haven't found that to be the case. You find good friends, you find great priests out there, and just to be encouraging of it, because we really need that.
To encourage others. As Father Frank said today, one person can make a difference. He, as a first and second grader, was encouraging and challenging his own parents to get connected a little bit more with their faith. And it transformed not only his life, but his whole family. And that call to the priesthood has brought him to affect so many other families and lives in our diocese. Once again, when we listen to that nudging of the heart and the words and the voice of God calling us to our vocation, we can transform our lives and so many others. When we do what God asks us to do, we certainly will live a wonderful life. Thanks for being with us today. As Catholics responding to the challenge of Bishop Barris to encourage dramatic missionary growth in the diocese, we use all forms of promoting the gospel, including television and social media. If you want to know any more about any of the priests we featured here, or have any questions or comments, you can email us at itsawonderfullife@telecaretv.org. Or you can tweet us at RVCVocations. We may even put up your comments during our show. You can also visit our website at longislandpriest.com. See you next time right here on It's a Wonderful Life.